Thank you. Moses received from the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight, and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said, Further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses did his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I will observe the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry and conquered their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a good and warm land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppressed them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. For Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be the sign of you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. For Moses said to God, If I come to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, Thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am who has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, Thus you shall say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. and showing honor. Do not lie in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Preserve in prayer. Contribute to the needs of all of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be hardy, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceable with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. This is the gospel of Christ.
Thank you. be honest with you, Father Jeff. Most members of mainline churches only have a vague idea of what it takes to be Orthodox compared to whatever else is going on around them. In fact, I would like to share a list of what I believe are some of the important things that are necessary for a church to be considered Orthodox or mainline. And I want the congregation to count on their hands and toes, their hands and fingers, their toes and fingers, what we believe. First of all, there's belief in the triune God who made us for himself. He is creator, he is redeemer, he is sanctifier, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Secondly, salvation is by works. No, it's by grace, and grace alone. Thirdly, Jesus has to be perfect God and perfect man for him to redeem us. Because if he's not perfect God, he can't even save himself. Let's go down the rest of this. The Holy Spirit is the third person in the Trinity who empowers us to walk in that life of grace. There are plenty Anglicans, Roman Catholics, what we call Lutherans, Presbyterians, who believe that there are two sacraments necessary for salvation, and that is baptism and Holy Communion. Remember in St. John's Gospel, chapter 3, Jesus told Nicodemus, chapter 3 and verse 5, unless you are born of water and the Spirit, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. And secondly, Holy Communion is the second sacrament necessary for our salvation. Again, I'm saying John's Gospel, chapter 5 and verse 53. Jesus literally says, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in me. But whosoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwell in me, and I in them, and I will raise them up at the last day. Mainline churches hold to at least three creedal statements. There is the baptismal creed, or what we call the Apostles' Creed. There is the Nicene Creed, which is the longer version, which gives us a full explanation of what we believe as Christians. And then there is the Athanasian Creed, written a few centuries later, but still containing the elements that are necessary for our salvation. We not only hold to those creeds, but I believe we also need to recognize the fact that we, as a mainline church, hold to a Bible that contains 81 books. No, I didn't say 66. 66 books is a Protestant invention from the Reformation period.
So how many books should we actually be subscribing?
There should be 81 books in every Bible that any Anglican, Roman Catholic, anybody who's a part of the mainline churches hold to. Let me say to you, you have 39 in the Old Testament, 15 in the Apocrypha, and 27 in the New Testament. And for a whole lot of people, when they go to purchase a Bible, they purchase what I call the Protestant Bible, which only contains 66 books. When they should buy a proper Bible so that they're able to follow as the passages are being read. Also, do not forget that the church that we belong to allowed us to develop what is known as the exegetical method of interpreting the scriptures. And there are four steps.
Wait, one second.
Okay.
Explain that word exegetical.
Exegetical means, it comes from the words exegesis, which basically means bringing or drawing forth from the text. In other words, it's not reading into the text, which is eisegesis, which most, unfortunately, sectarian churches do, or proof text, what they want to do. We want to draw out of the scriptures what is actually there. And there are four basic steps that are required of us.
Let me get it, Darren, because I want to make sure that I am doing the proper methods of exegesis.
All right. The first thing you do when you read your scriptures is that you need to place the passage into its historical context. In other words, it is written at a particular time, it is written in a particular place, it is written to a particular set of people, it is written in the midst of a particular culture, it is written with certain backgrounds and beliefs that lie behind it, and you have to do that. You have to do the hard work. Secondly, you must allow the passage to speak to the people of its time. In other words, what was it trying to say to that particular generation? Thirdly, you need to identify what we call the abiding message. And that message remains the same yesterday, today, and remain that way forever. And the fourth step is taking that abiding message and applying it to our present day context. And that is how you do proper exegetical work of drawing out of the scriptures what is supposed to be there.
Wow. That sounds like a sermon I want to go to here.
Well, let me say this to you. We've been doing that in Bible studies since I came here. And we do it every Tuesday in terms of grappling with the text and grappling with the context. I believe that mainline churches are very mission-orientated. They set mission as a priority in terms of reaching out to souls and bringing them into the kingdom. We also believe that as a mainline church, we practice what we call the threefold ordained ministry of the church, which is bishops, priests, and deacons. That has been so not only from the pages of the New Testament, but it's come down to the patristic era. It has kept with us all the way through these many years. There's also people need to understand that salvation is a process. One of the biggest drawbacks for sectarian churches is that they give people the impression that you get it all one time. But the truth is that you are saved 2,000 years ago by Jesus' action. You are being saved by Jesus right here and right now. And you will be saved when you get to heaven. In other words, it's a process.
Wow. Can I surely put some perspective in my thoughts? Because many times I'm hearing persons going around telling persons that they saved and not saved. And I wonder now, didn't Jesus do it once and once for all? And here it is now, we got people trying to tell me that I'm not saved.
The problem is that I remember in an airport, and we'll call the person's name, but the lady approached me and said, "I didn't know the old Anglicans were Christians. I didn't even know God was saved." And the sad part about it is I said, this is why we get in trouble, because you all read Romans chapter 10 and you take it out of context. It says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved." Get it right? The tense says will. Yeah? And I believe people make that mistake. When we talk about entering into the church, there are three ways in the New Testament by which people enter the church. They enter, first of all, by sacramentally, by baptism. They enter by conversion. That's what happened to St. Paul. He was converted on the road to Damascus. And the third way is what we see in Cornelius' household, when the Spirit of God didn't just fall upon Jesus, it fell on everybody. His children, his grandchildren, his slaves, all of their children. That's why Peter said he can't deny people baptism, because they've already entered into the body of Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit.
So, Kian, let me understand this. So, all these people are here trying to tell me that they ain't got no church or they don't believe.
Listen, the problem is this, that most people are practicing John's baptism. And John's baptism was one of repentance. In other words, John was calling them to forgive, to ask forgiveness for their sins by coming and repenting. Jesus' baptism, on the other hand, is not from below, but rather from above. Because when we are baptized in the name of is a legal term, it meant to become the property of. And so when we are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we become the property of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, how many of these people in this congregation believe that they belong to God? You've been baptized, every hand in here should go up. And the strategy is this, that a lot of people don't understand. They think, oh, the child can't respond, the child can't do this and the other. I tell people all the time, if God has to wait for people to respond to him before he can give them grace, that's not grace, that's payment. You get the point? That's payment. And that's where people make the biggest mistake in their life. Grace is not payment because you happen to step into the plate. Grace is God's undeserved favor that he pours on every last one of us. On the good, the bad, the indifferent, he pours on everybody. And that's why people make mistakes.
So, Jana, let me get this right. In the sense now, all these people who hide from church, in a sense now, they are there thinking that they are special. But they are here to realize that they are the property of God.
Exactly.
And being the property of God, or being someone's property, should indeed make you special. And so I feel that you got a lot going on when you say that, and for persons not to buy in, or persons not to understand where you are coming from. It's probably they have not heard this before, or maybe they've been hearing something from somewhere else that's just been getting in the way of what we've been saying.
That's right. And the sad part about it is that for so many people, they begin to believe the lie that is told them that when they were baptized as children, that they were just simply christened.
I thought they christened goats and those things.
That's what you do with goats.
So
but I know goats. I'm the property of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And when you bring your child for baptism, you are literally saying, yes, God, I want this child to be your child. I want you to be this child, God. You're giving them back to the one who gave them to you. And we bring our children up from the time we bring them from the font to the time they come to the bishop, to the time they move on to take over communion. All of it is to recognize in their own lives that they are not their own. They have been bought by Christ. And that Christ is the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Wow. I'm so happy to hear that, because sometimes when I go and I see baptism, I think it's all about dressing up. Coming there in sequence.
Mm-hmm.
And ensuring that the caterer was there on time for the church going on.
And then the worst part about it is we take our time out to introduce this new member to the church. And as soon as baptism is over, out the door. Because they got to be ready for the party. And you wonder to yourself, well, what kind of Anglicans they are? And they move right up, and that's why you're in trouble.
You even want to say anything?
You don't bring that back to me. The point is that you're supposed to be saved for the whole meal, the wonderful meal that Christ himself has given to his church. Let me just say a few things else about mainline churches. Mainline churches follow a calendar that helps us to go through the drama of salvation. We celebrate Christmas not because it's the birthday of Jesus. We celebrate Christmas because it has to do with Jesus' incarnation, with him taking on human flesh to restore the image of God in us. In other words, our process of salvation does not begin at the cross. It begins with Jesus coming to take on human flesh for us. In other words, every feast day in the life of the church, every last person who claimed to be an Anglican needs to find yourself there. Because the sad part of it is that they don't understand the message of salvation. That's why they don't show up.
That's very interesting, because sometimes you wonder if the AC is a bit too cold, because you know they say that not enough people in the room, the AC could be a little there.
The thing is the AC. It has a lot to do with people not being serious about their faith and about their journey.
So you mean God came here 2,000 years ago to save us from our sins, the sins we didn't even know we was going to commit?
Mm-hmm.
We're not even grateful.
No.
That don't sound a bit harsh. But please tell me more about these mainline churches.
Mainline churches emphasize not just personal commitment, but the commitment of the body. In other words, I just can't be concerned about my salvation, me and my Jesus. I need to be concerned about the rest of people around me, whether they're going to be on the pathway to salvation. In other words, I got to be concerned about you, I got to be concerned about the rest of the people. And it's not just because I'm a clergyman, but rather everybody inside of there, we need to understand that we have an impact on the people's lives who surround us. We need to recognize the fact that the church is always made our priority in terms of the guidance of the Holy Spirit, in evangelism, in stewardship, in disciple making, in the didactic or the teaching ministry of the church. All of it is to help us to get where we need to be in our journey with Him.
That's very interesting, and I like how you outlined the structure and the components in which we have to look for in mainline churches. But funny that you say this, but if all of that makes up our faith to help keep us on the right track, why so many Anglicans go astray by turning to these sectarian movements?
Let me just say this to you, Reverend Father. The church has fallen down for several reasons. First of all, the church has not reinforced what has been handed on to it. In other words, we are being lax in terms of teaching all of those things that I just finished talking about. People do not know what are the essentials for their salvation. In fact, the problem is that many of us do not want strong teaching. And there are many of us who don't hunger for learning in terms of moving forward and maturing in our faith. The young will believe that once they're confirmed, they graduated. They head of the class now. They safe, they secure. And there are many people who believe that once they make Holy Communion, it's going down. So you all hurry up so we can get to the Holy Communion and I can go home. Go about my business, go shopping. There's some who believe that, like you said, Terry's teacher, once you find Jesus, that's it. You finish. You arrive. And there are others who believe that all of what I talked about before is not necessary for them in terms of their salvation. That's a burden. That's a big burden they don't want to be interested in. And most people leave mainline churches and they go right back into these sectarian movements, and listen carefully, Father. They go back into these sectarian movements who, unfortunately, because they do not have a grasp on the truth, lead them right back into the same errors that the church faced in the first 5 centuries of its existence.
So, Cameron, you needed to tell me that you believe in all this goodness to go somewhere that carries.
That's right.
What was the point of that? Well, I guess maybe if you didn't know, you'll never know.
Well, the problem is that how many of us want to know? And then the tragedy is that you meet some of our own people later on in life and you ask, well, where have you been? Oh, Father, I've been down the road and I found the truth. because you didn't go and search for him.
And as you say that, and as you bring to the attention of things that these sectarian movements are doing, or what they are not doing, I always wondered why we did all of these things. Some persons would come to me and say, "Oh, you like it? You just call them smells and them bells." And I say to them, "What do you mean? I thought those things had purpose." So tell me that you think our church is smells and bells, but don't even know what the smells and the bells are for. That makes me wonder if you did any research about our church to have anything to actually say.
And if you did, then you would be able to answer a lot of the sectarian churches that come to us and attack us. But unfortunately, there are plenty of Anglicans who don't know what to say and how to answer. They wait for somebody to knock on their door on Saturday morning, and then they say, "We want to show you a little piece of scripture here." And they show them a piece of scripture, and their head spins. And they leave the church to go supposedly to find the truth in a religion that's going to take them further back from where they're supposed to be. You have another question, Paul?
Well, you get me a little deep in these questions. I hope that I don't get confused and throw off and go searching for the truth somewhere else. But what is the problem with most of these sectarian movements and churches? When we think about, we have, as they always say, the Bahamas have the most churches in the world.
Yeah.
And then they also say now if they got the most churches, then they probably got the most baths, because every church got a bath on the corner of the church. And so
they probably have number of students.
But then when you think about it, it's always as I continue to grow and mature, I'm seeing new churches pop up with new names. I'm seeing churches with names. I'm trying to figure out, how does that even make sense?
Let me say this, Father. The biggest problem with sectarian movements, or what we call churches, is this. They pick one or two or three areas that they focus on. They don't want all the stuff that I just finished talking about in the mainline churches. They just want to pick one or two things and then try to twist it and interpret it in their mind so that they're able to get across to their people. Let me share with you some things that they tell us we're doing wrong and why they reject the Anglican church. Not just for the smells and bells. And you see, even when it comes to the smells and bells, they go back to Isaiah chapter 1, where they try to tell people that, see, incense is an abomination to the Lord. And I always think about Isaiah 7, see, you put your foot in your because you didn't read the passage carefully. I said, look at what Isaiah says. It says, God says that religion is making him sick, because what they're doing ain't much what they are worshiping at the end of the day. The God that they worship is the Holy God. And he demands holiness from them. And so I take them back, I said, look at Isaiah chapter 1, it says, who requires this trampling my thoughts? I said, didn't you all go into your church on Sunday, didn't you all have a time to just stamp your feet? But God hated and despised that too. He hated and despised you for raising up your hands. He hates all your long prayers. No, I don't think that's what that passage means. I said, well, why all of a sudden you pick him on the incense bit? But you're going to read the passage talking. You're picking and choosing what you want rather than doing what is necessary. Let me just quickly go down the list.
Sorry, Dan.
No problem. There are plenty of people who tell them, you're all disqualified because you baptized infants. And I already mentioned that. We disqualified because the Holy Communion is necessary. It's just a memorial snap time. As far as some of them are concerned, they can go to a bar room and sit down and pour some crackers and a bottle of wine and sit there and remember Jesus. It's a memorial snack time for them. There are some people who hold or cling to a particular commandment, particularly the Sabbath commandment, and they claim that if you're keeping the Sabbath by worshiping on the Sabbath, you ain't Christian. And I need to say this well, so many people in this church will understand. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you must worship only on the Sabbath. There is no such law in the scriptures. In fact, Jews worship every day of the week. Every day. Psalm 34 tells us quite clearly, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. And I tell you all the time, we have no real Sabbath day keepers in the Bahamas. Because the Sabbath, anybody who broke the Sabbath, they would be put automatically to death. And I tell people all the time, there are no real Sabbath keepers in the Bahamas. But I wrote a paper, I produced it, photocopied it, I left it on the table there, the table in the back of the Matthews. I wonder how many people here read it. Because then they would realize that there are no Sabbath keepers. They tell that young people, when our guys and girls go out and meet up with some of those people from that particular denomination, they basically tell them, you can't marry that person because they don't belong to our faith. So they tell them the only way you can marry is when you leave your faith to come and join us. Then you can marry them. So we got plenty of young people who decide to step off from being Anglican to become a get the church. Live in error. Oh, love so sweet and yet so black. There are a whole host of people, let me say this to you, that the sectarians are smart people. They try to teach them how to go into the text and literally interpret the Bible. They take a proof text and they say that is the scripture that proves their point. And they take it out of context altogether. And unfortunately, because people don't do the exegetical work, they end up messing up themselves. They say that only praise and worship is important. That's the only thing that's important. All I need is a little bit of praise and worship, a little bit of teaching, and I said. But what happened to what Jesus had to say? Jesus commanded, instituted, ordained all of his church. Keep on doing this until I come again. You want to know why Anglicans do what they do every Sunday? Why they do it every day of the week? It's because Jesus ordered it to be so. So we worship him without any reference to God. And unfortunately, the list just simply goes right on.
As the piano, and thinking about our worship style, what we do there in church, looking at liturgical freedom, it is interpreted as freedom in the spirit. But they have yet to follow the commandments of Christ when it comes to worship.
That's right.
Can you explain that a little bit for me?
Just as I said, the tragedy is that we take Holy Communion and we throw it out of it. And what they consider to be worship, let me tell you, when people tell you they have free worship, they worship being free. Everything has a structure. They come in, they do praise and worship. They have the opening prayer. Then they have the opening hymn. Then somebody gives a scripture reading. Then you have testimony time. When you finish testimony time, then the time to take up the offering. When the offering is taken up, then you have the ministry of the word. When we get the ministry of the word, they have altar call after that. When altar call finished, they have a little bit more praise and worship, and then they go home. And people tell me, oh, that's free worship. No, it's structured worship. You just didn't put it down on paper.
Wow. So all this time, you know, the persons out there on one of you each gather another, shouting and praying and getting the spirit flowing down and getting on the sunny. I thought that that was free worship because they came into the lights in the building. But I'm glad you kind of explained
What is not there? Like exegesis, it has four steps. You start off with your belief in the 21st century. You then flip to your Bible and find a truth text. And then you decide that that truth text is your absolute abiding truth. And you take that half truth and you try to tell the whole world this is the truth of what we're teaching. It's like, remember you shared a story with me the other day about Jeremiah chapter 10, where the people cut down trees, trim them down, put gold over them, and the rest of it, and somebody told you, oh, that's the Christmas tree.
Yeah.
That's a bunch of rubbish. They're talking about making idols.
Exactly.
It has nothing to do with a Christmas tree. Jesus wasn't even around.
My point exactly. And so when we think about this idea of eisegesis, there's many times when I go to other churches, not like Anglican, I find out that I haven't learned anything at all.
Well, the stuff I thought was sometimes a little scary for me. I remember sitting in a church in Long Island, they brought this lady over from Exuma, and the lady, she was reading out of Isaiah chapter 3. Isaiah chapter 3 dealt with the Assyrians carrying the children of Israel off into exile, scattering them throughout the empire. And what they did is that they had the habit of not only stripping them totally naked, but shaving off all their hair. And the woman used Isaiah chapters 3 to talk about how she lost so many things. When she was coming across, she lost her wedding band. And the pew I was sitting in, I started to move a little further down to the edge of the pew. Because if she really understood the text, I figured she was going to take off not just the wedding ring, but she was about to lose her scarf, and she was about to lose her other things. And I didn't need to be there to see that. So unfortunately, you got to be careful. I tell people the wrong question in the first day group up. There's a place in your house that you will discover very quickly how good friends you are with a particular bowl. And I don't think serious about either. Most sectarian churches do not have a creed statement. They just make it up as they go along. Most sectarian churches lack the depth that we have in mainline churches. Most sectarian churches appeal to the young, because they put on a good light and show. What they used to in the secular world in terms of going to the nightclub and seeing the music and hearing the music and seeing the light flash and the rest of it, that's exactly the kind of show they put on. So people just pack up and say, oh, you know, I'm going to do that. I don't know, get up with that.
So it's like moving from one club to the next.
Of course. And most sectarian churches keep their new converts by doing something very simple for them. The minute they suck in Anglicans who ain't doing nothing in their church, all the years they've been sitting down inside the Anglican churches, they give them title and they give them a job to do so they can keep them right here. And the tragedy is that that's where plenty of Anglicans get sucked right in. And unfortunately, they lose their way because they believe that they're making a contribution to a system that they don't even understand that's taking them further away. And I really believe that the problem is that for so many persons, they can't break free because their churches will brainwash them, put the blinders on so that they can only see their little piece of doctrine that they're holding on to.
If that is how the sectarian movements and churches operate, how are cults any different from that?
Cults are worse. Worse stuff. Cults, on the other hand, they dismiss everything and every doctrine, particularly when it comes to our salvation. And let me give you a list. Okay? There are people who unfortunately end up with only Almighty God, and they dismiss every other doctrine that we have. Jesus is treated as a hybrid creature. He is not the Almighty God. He is not completely human, but he's not completely God. And worst of all, the Holy Spirit, lower than Jesus. In fact, he has no personality. The tragedy is that salvation is achieved by works in many cases. People don't realize this. The Jehovah's Witnesses, they are mandated that every month they have to put 25 hours of witnessing in. So they go on the streets so that they can wrap up their 25 hours. If they don't wrap up their 25 hours, they get put on the assembly.
So wait a minute now. You mean that they're you guys are Anglicans who leave the church to go be the Jehovah's Witness to get taxed for that 25 hours on Saturday?
That's right. That's right. And Father, you best meet Jesus. They gotta make sure they put in their timesheet. Not only that, but they gotta put in a certain amount of money and the sales of the material of the Watchtower Society. But I won't get into that right now because we're gonna come to deal with Jehovah's Witness in detail. So I'm looking to understand how to answer them.
I'm sure I'll be able to.
You wait until you get up with the new world, the new birth. That you only experience the new birth after you're dead and gone. There's some people, unfortunately, the cults, usually started by people discontented with their religion. They're upset because somebody upset them or organized religion is on the place altogether. So they start off their own church, their own cult. There are people who unfortunately have no theological backing, no theological training, no exegetical skills, and they grab up the book and they say they know what the book is saying. That's one of the reasons why I'm wrecking my brain about trying to print my book on Revelation, because I want to tell people that we've been reading Revelation wrong because we let the sectarians and the cults hijack our Bible. Yeah? There are plenty of people who, unfortunately, when it comes to cults, they create their own books, their own Bibles. The Jehovah's Witnesses don't have a Bible like ours. They use what is known as the New World Translation of the Bible, altered and changed to suit their doctrine. When you go to a hotel in the United States, even over in Paradise Island, you open the drawer, there's the Book of Mormons there. The Mormons are located on Soldier Road. And only Jesus knows how they get here. Because don't forget, until 1978, they taught that the color of your skin indicated the depth of your sin. Look at some of the people around
here. They were choosing famous then.
Finally, the only one who did. Then you are the racist, isn't it? Cults do something else. They get them to become disillusioned with their religion. They get them to cut off their family members. And I might as well tell you, I have had a person come to me from the U.S. Embassy because in one particular case, they took the person out of the country and carried them elsewhere, just to indoctrinate them and lead them totally astray. Cults are known to get people out of community. They allow all sorts of strange behavior. The children of the vineyard ministry who started off from a church on Wolf Road. Lady Kalana, the people told her, "Oh, don't worry, your blood is atoning for your sin." So, what's the stop from cutting her wrist and killing herself? Because she is now believing that they're telling her that her blood is going to atone for her own sin. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me clean with it? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. In other words, Father, they exercise peculiar behaviors that are not acceptable. And worst of all, cults are unforgiving. If you fall out of fellowship, they write you up and you sit at the back in the corner. Because they do not want you to contaminate the rest of the body. some people leave because not of the richness of our faith being offered to them. They leave because that true religion for them is where they are not the center. And they believe that it's supposed to be about me. For me. The focus is me, not God, not Jesus, it's me. Some people leave because they get hurt by somebody who said something to them, did something to them, or caused them to get upset. And again, they don't realize Jesus says, in this world you will have tribulations, you will have trouble. I mean, I know it's a priest. You just start now. But I've been around for some 36 years now. And I can tell you right now, there are plenty of people who are my friends. But at the end of the day, it ain't about me. It's about God who's in the center. There are people who leave because they do not want to take the time to explore their faith. They want to be spoon-fed. They just want, here we go, one more dose. One more dose, rather than get into it and go and search out the truth. There are people who leave because they claim that someone opened their eyes to the truth in some other peculiar setting. And unfortunately, if you listen to what I said this morning about sectarians and those who are part of cults, they leave and leave not into the light, but into darkness. And most of all, there are some of us who leave because unfortunately we want things to be easy. People tell me all the time, oh, Father Times, what you're trying to do, I don't know why you're preaching long sermons and why you're trying to tell us in this direction, why you're trying to move us in this way. If you're trying to teach old dog new tricks. And I have to remind them, first of all, you ain't no dog. And secondly, this is not a trick. This is life in the body of Christ, and it requires us to take life seriously if we're going to go and get to where we need to
go. Amen. Indeed, food for thought, indeed, insight. And I hope that by listening and hearing this discussion, that all eyes will be open. The things about this church, the richness of our Anglican heritage, to not take lightly the things that we do here, to recognize that it is indeed all with purpose, all with meaning, all rooted and grounded in the scriptures. That when we don't understand something or something seems a little confusing or hard, come to the right people. Ask the questions as opposed to looking for the answers elsewhere. When we think about sectarians and cults, they are plaguing our churches for too long and losing many of our young persons. And so I hope by this discussion that we have, that we will be edified and continue.
One of the things that I want to say to you, Father, is this, that we've sat passively with Anglicans, and we've allowed these people to make inroads in so many of our churches and carry our members away. What we need is an army of people to stand up in the truth and deliver the word as it's been given to the saints of all. That's going to be the challenge. And hopefully over the next couple of weeks while we're dealing with the sectarians and the cults in this country in media, there are going to be some of us who will sit up and pay attention because we're facing a battle over souls. I wouldn't want my children to get lost. I hope and pray the people of St. Matthew's will wake up and realize we're in a life and death struggle.
intercessions are found on page 7 of the bulletins. Let us pray for the fellowship of the Church of Christ and for all God's creatures. Father in heaven, with all who confess the name of Jesus as Lord and Savior, we offer our prayers and praises in spirit and in truth. Father in heaven, with Jesus Christ, our great high priest, whoever lives to intercede for us, we uphold all ministers of God's word and sacraments, that they may fulfill their high calling in the faith. Father in heaven, we pray for the unfailing guidance of the Holy Spirit on those who are called to interpret and expound the will of the King to others. Father in heaven, we pray for all organizations within the fellowship of the body of Christ, that their work may edify the people of God and bear faithful witness to the gospel. Father in heaven, we pray for all persons who do not share our confession of faith, that with courage, truth, and love, we may work together with them and promote the common good. Father in heaven, for the leaders of our country and all who make decisions on our behalf, that they may be guided by the Spirit to direct our affairs in righteousness and peace. Father in heaven,
hear our prayer.
For our judges, magistrates, and all who administer justice, that in all things they may seek to do your will and to protect the rights and freedom of your people. Father in heaven,
hear our prayer.
In our schools and in all other places of learning, may true knowledge, sound wisdom, and godly discipline ever be found. Father in heaven,
hear our prayer.
To the poor, the hungry, the unemployed, and all victims of persecution and discrimination of any kind, may God in Christ help us all to bring relief, justice, and protection. Father in heaven,
hear our prayer.
To all who suffer now from pain and disease, from human discomfort and misery, may God in Christ bring healing and joy for the renewal of their faith. Father in heaven, that we may use aright the fullness of the earth, that our pursuits in science and the advancement of our skills may ever be in the service of that true humanity which is created in the image of God. Father in heaven, that we may never become the slaves of money or of the lust for power, but we may rather strive for victory through the power of love. Father in heaven, that with all who belong to the communion of saints, both living and departed, we may ever rejoice in the blessed assurance of that hope which has been won for us in Christ. Father in heaven,
let us therefore confess our sins. God, the body of Christ, by the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, and have all been made to drink of the one Spirit.
Thank you. Good morning, church. I beg your indulgence for just a few minutes on this, our after-school Sunday. At present, I'd like to ask all those who would have graduated high school, if we have any here at 7:15, who would have graduated high school in June.
Your school uniform, your PR in the back, who's wearing a new t-shirt.
We have Kyle, who's in his uniform. Next year, we know that all of us, well, those who still be in school, will be in our school uniforms, yeah? Just some instructions for the distribution of the back to school bags. We have enough for who's here. And so, during the communion, we're going to, once they would receive communion or that blessing, they can make, they will take the rite into the chapel where they will be gifted with their, where you will be gifted with your back to school package. Once again, thank you very much.
Thank you. your great love, you fashioned us in your image. In your tender compassion, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, to share our human nature. In the power of the Holy Spirit, you overcame the power of sin and death and brought your people to new birth as first fruits of your new creation. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." St. Joseph, our spouse, St. John the Baptist, our patron, St. Peter, St. Paul,
Morning, church.
Morning.
Those who sit there. We want to thank Frank and Catherine Campbell for sponsoring this week's bulletin and Thanksgiving for their wedding anniversary to be celebrated tomorrow. So let us pray for them that they continue to have a wonderful marriage. Please note that Mr. Barry Ross, that's the gentleman who sits in the back in the corner with his wife, he's in the hospital, that he suffered a stroke. So let us pray for him as well. As a parish family, we offer our condolences and our prayers to Marsha Thompson and her family on the passing of retired reserve superintendent Craig Thompson, I know as Captain Thompson, which died in Nassau Bahamas, who passed away on Tuesday. And also we want to offer our condolences and our prayers to Gia Davis on the passing of her mother, Pat Thomas, and also to Antoinette Rutherford and her family on the passing of her husband, Anthony Rutherford, as well as his siblings, Jackie Rutherford and Pandora Darling, and the rest of the family. And let's pray for all others who this week are mourning the loss of loved ones. Please note that due to the unexpected extensive work still being done in the parish hall, it remains closed until further notice. Members of the Dutch Board, your monthly meeting resumes on Wednesday, 6 p.m. to be upstairs in the conference room. And now, even though we are invited to join the families and Berries as they celebrate their patronal festival today at 3 p.m., we are having even some benediction here, St. Matthew's, at 6 p.m. So even though you invite the Berries and Berries, you also invite Couples in Matthew's at 6 p.m. Starting with some sermon and benediction. Parents and guardians, you're reminded that church school will be open on September the 9th, Saturday at 9:30 a.m. and will meet in the conference room upstairs. If you notice, St. Matthew's Anglican Church Social Outreach Ministry now. That's for our annual stakeout and mini fair, which will be held on Saturday, October the 28th, from 12 noon until. Tickets are priced at $15 for fish or steak, or chicken or steak. Now, this is our event, this is a big event for our social outreach ministry, where we hope to raise as much funds as possible. We're asking for your support, please. Cooking has the tickets for the sale 15 service to sit very well in the corner. You get tickets? Yeah, you got tickets, I see you. I hope you can see the tickets because you're getting on your glasses. Please, let us support this our ministry, where we use the money to help those who are less fortunate than we are around our parish and elsewhere. They can feed you on the usual rhubarb, cakes, pies, and other baked goods, homemade ice cream, and all that stuff. So please, let us do our best to support our outreach ministry and our annual stakeout and mini fair. Now, even though the social outreach ministry having an annual stakeout and fair, they still prepare food items to assist the needy last Friday in each month. So they're still in need of food items like tuna, sardines, corn beef, that kind of stuff to put into food packages. So please, don't forget that as well. get there at 7 o'clock, if we, those who still have not made their contribution can still make their contribution and to complete their prayers, please. If you look in your bulletins this morning, you see the date of baptism. When we hold baptism and you see confirmation classes, they begin on the 13th of September. Please, read it so you know to get your materials for confirmation, please. Also read about the Anglican Theological Institute, what it's all about, and if you are interested. Also in your bulletin would be marriage preparation classes for those who wish to be married and those who want to try it again. So please read about that in your bulletins as well. Bible study has begun to be every Tuesday here in the church at 6 p.m. Now, this is September. On Sunday is September the 24th. We celebrate our St. Matthew's Patronal Festival. We ask thee for donations for our reception. Then you can make your donation available to Deborah Taylor, Sharon Ferguson, Eric Sherman, or Keith Storm, or put in the envelope, and this mark on the witness for refreshments. So please, our Patronal Festival, Sunday, September the 24th, and we ask thee for donations for our reception, please. Please do. We still ask you to update your membership information for our events. Please, again, as I always say, as we enjoy what we have, let us remember those who do not have. Let us do our best to always be Christians 24/7. Let's pray for our country. There's still too many murders for a country our size, too much abuse, especially of young children. Let us pray for our country. God hears prayers. Let us pray that we let it in peace with one another, as God wishes us to do. And so may God peace, blessing, and love be with us all until we meet here again. God bless all of us.